Throughout the 1950s, moviegoing and pop culture was drastically changing. The birth of rock and roll music and the increase in drive-in movie theatres created a new culture aimed at a new group, the American teenager. Filmmakers and studios took notice of this and started tailoring their movies towards this new demographic, creating fun, popcorn midnight movies that were cheap and quick to make and would play in double bills at drive-in movie theatres.
Beware of the blob, it creeps and leaps and lies.
Film producer Jack Harris decided to make a movie that cashed in on the wave of alien invasion films, but one that would tonally stand apart from the likes of War of the Worlds or Invasion of the Body Snatchers. This would be much more jovial, more fun, packed with colourful visuals and even a novelty theme song, not to mention a hot new up-and-coming actor called Steve McQueen as the young, cool teen hero.
Beware of the blob, it creeps.
This flawed film, in many ways, became the quintessential 50s alien monster movie. One that continues to have a cult following to this day, would go on to inspire new, young, up-and-coming horror filmmakers, and would even spark a masterful cult classic of a remake in the late 80s. Join me as we continue exploring the evolution of alien horror, as we discuss both Irvin Yeaworth's and Chuck Russell's The Blob. Welcome back to the Evolution of Horror. My name is Mike Munzer, and as ever, I am your host. If you're tuning in for the first time, then welcome. In this podcast, we explore and dissect the history and the evolution of the horror genre by looking at particular subgenres one series at a time. We are currently in the middle of our seventh series exploring the evolution of alien sci-fi and cosmic horror, and this is part four. This episode is sponsored by $20 Patreon subscriber Liberty, and in this episode, as the intro suggested, we are going to be deep diving into two versions of the classic alien monster movie, The Blob. That's The Blob from 1958 and The Blob from 1988. Both of these discussions will be spoilerific. Give them both a watch if you can before listening to our discussion. So I'm going to get straight into it. Joining me to discuss all things The Blob, a longtime friend of the podcast. She was last here discussing House of the Devil with me on our occult series. So it's a pleasure to have her back. Welcome back to the podcast, filmmaker, writer, director, among many other things, Cat Davies. Hello.
Hello. How are you, Mike?
Hello. I am very good. Thank you. So lovely to chat to you again. It's been a while. How's this last year been for you?
It's great. It's been sex, drugs, rock and roll.
Just wild, I know.
It's been wild. It's been ultimate beastmaster. It's been vaccines in my arm. It's been a serious lack of vitamin D. My teeth are ultra sensitive. My nails are cracked. I haven't had a haircut since December 2 years ago.
Oh God.
It's good other than that.
Do you know the first time you came on the podcast, we talked about Day of the Dead, right? And I feel a little bit like those characters in that bunker in Day of the Dead. Like that's become our reality now, hasn't it, I think?
I think we did even joke about, can you imagine living without sunshine? And yeah, without social interaction, and just how would that be? I feel like we've smashed it. I feel like now we could actually probably cope with literally anything.
Yeah, we've come through to the other side, you know, haven't we? That's the thing. It's like
it does feel like this has been our generation's kind of this is like overstating it somewhat, but like my nan and my granddad had the war years.
Yeah,
this
yeah.
has felt like a war decade in a year. I mean, I have genuinely aged about 10 years in yeah. just over a year. It's been grueling, but at the same time, you know, it's been good because it's made me spend less money in pubs.
Yeah, right. I can't believe how much money I've probably saved this last year.
Super flush. I've not done anything. Yeah. I've not been to galleries. I've not been to pubs. I've not been to restaurants. I cancelled subscriptions.
I mean, I've bought a house and I think I'm better off than I was, you know? Like, it's been, yeah, that is so true. Has lockdown affected your kind of horror viewing habits or tastes? Like, I've spoken to a couple of people who are like, I can't handle watching anything that bleak and dark anymore. And then other people have gone the opposite way, where they're like, horror has been like a comfort blanket to me, you know?
I think I'm probably a bit of a weirdo, as I say every time we talk, in that because I grew up with quite bleak and dark horror, it hasn't really changed for me. I do think I'm slightly desensitized in some way to horror kind of having that kind of impact on me now. It takes a lot to have an impact. So more recently, I started watching Them on Amazon, and I've got to say that is probably that and The Nightingale, which I watched on Netflix over lockdown, and I meant to watch it so long ago, and I'd actually started watching it on a screener link, but those two absolutely stop me sleeping and give me nightmares. Other than that, it doesn't matter how brutal or gruesome the horror is, it doesn't have that kind of impact on me. So I just watch it because I'm interested in it in a genre and how it's changing and mutating and growing through sort of sub-genres. And there's always like a little fashionable, here's the horror of the moment, either it's folk horror or witches are back or it's zombies. But at the moment, there's a lot of stuff that's very kind of social historical horror, which is really interesting. I do find that kind of thing more impactful. Things like Lovecraft Country as well. That was really, really good.
Yeah. And Them, right? Them is the perfect example of that. That is a really grueling... I very rarely get so disturbed by something that I like bow out of it. But I've stopped after, I think, episode six, maybe. And it's not that it wasn't good. It was excellent. And I do still plan to finish it. But it's tough, right? It is like... I personally found it very disturbing. And affecting, like you said, it kind of gives you sleepless nights, doesn't
it? Yeah, and I think I've watched some other fun stuff in lockdown, like we watched Scare Me on Shudder, which is such great fun. That's a lovely comfort blanket and really funny contained horror, like done on a really small budget but very, very fun, with lead actress who was in The Boys. That was great fun. But on the flip side of it, you know, things like Them and Lovecraft Country, they just, they're quite full-on and disturbing, but also really interesting and so beautifully made and stylish. But it's just, there's one of those episodes where it opens with violence against a minor, and you're like...
Yeah, that is... I think that was the one where I was like, holy shit.
I was like, I've never seen that kind of warning come up on anything before, and I think I've kind of seen everything. So it's kind of a case of strap yourself in, but I've still been watching it, but I've paced myself bit by bit, ep by ep.
That's it. You gotta spread it out a little bit. So what about aliens? We're talking all about aliens, alien movies on this series of the podcast, UFOs and cosmic horror and all of this kind of stuff. Are you a fan of that kind of subgenre, Kat? Do you like these sorts of movies?
I do. I really do. I think alien movies, probably some of the first horror that I saw. I think the first... one I ever saw, we've probably been through this before, was probably Dream Warriors, which we'll come on to later. I think that, or The Evil Dead, probably my first horror films. But outside of that, Aliens, not Alien, Aliens, which I love, I still think is better than the first one. Everyone's going to hate me for that. but also The Stuff, which, fantastic Larry Cohen film, and very much like what we'll come on to. But those were the kind of earliest kind of alien movies. And Body Snatchers, the 70s version with Jeff Goldblum and Leonard Nimoy and Donald Sutherland. That, I mean, there's so much you can do with the trope of an alien, because what does an alien really mean? Is it, is it an H.R. Giger vision, or is it... you know, a kind of possession, or is it an amoeba? What is it? I do love alien films, apart from Species.
The Species is crap.
I mean, I think she's, what a beautiful actress, but oh my god, okay, she's horny, she's just put on that on the planet to breed, and she's gonna go for Alfred Molina. Why not
You know, I mean, that's the thing, alien movies, and this is probably something we'll talk about in a minute, but they are often associated with like B movies too, right? Particularly in the 50s and then probably again in the 80s, that idea that like alien movies were often thought of as kind of trashy late night movies almost, right? And that kind of thing. And I think that's because they're so often associated with like creature effects and gloopy things and all of that kind of stuff, I suppose. And yeah, I think that it gives them a certain reputation. But when they're done well, like you say, Aliens, Alien, like the kind of Xenomorph and The Thing and yeah. things like that, it's like these are some incredible Alien films. Yeah.
Do you know one of my favourites though, my God, this is such a weird thing. Yeah. One of my favourite Alien movies is actually an Alien kind of musical. It's called... the things to be ashamed of. Earth Girls Are Easy. It's a Julian Temple film with Jeff Goldblum, Jim Carrey, and Damon Wayans with Gina Davis. And they're basically sexy hairy aliens that crash land into Gina Davis's pool. And they get shaved and then they look human. And it's this really interesting, weird little 80s musical.
Oh, that's brilliant.
But like Julian Temple did Absolute Beginners, so of course it's this lovely visual musical spectacle. And I'm not ashamed of it, actually. I think it's a great piece and I think it's really cult and really fun and lovely. And yeah. Jeff Goldblum is, I mean, Goldblum's
what
sexy.
A hero.
I mean, what can you do? You've got to love him.
I know, absolutely. And there was me looking, because I'm doing Rocky Horror Picture Show, because I was like, well, there's a good Alien
musical. Oh, that's fantastic.
But there you go. It sounds like I've got another one I should check out to pair it with.
You have to look up Earth Girls Are Easy. When a few years ago, I went to a Thor Ragnarok BAFTA screening and Taika Waititi was there and Jeff Goldblum. Mm-hmm. And it was a kind of question and answer and it was any questions. And I just went, will there be a sequel to Earth Girls Are Easy, Jeff? And he just kind of looked down at his feet and he was like, no, sadly not, no.
Oh, well, never mind. All right, well, we are going to get into our double bill of blobs, Kat. We've got two blobs to talk about, very important blobs. We're going to begin with the first blob. So let's begin our deep dive discussion of The Blob from 1958.
Every one of you watching this screen, look out, because soon, very soon, the most horrifying monster menace ever conceived will be oozing into this theater. Two teenagers see it first, like a falling star from outer space.
Boy, that was close. Hey, come on, I want to see if I can find it.
An old man finds it, touches it, and this is the shocking result. From then on, there's no stopping the blob as it spreads from town to town.
Basically, a strange meteorite lands on Earth. A farmer decides to crack it open, mm-hmm. and it unleashes this strange alien amoeba, which attaches itself to his arm and then decides that it will attack him and consume him and assimilate with him and then starts to basically eat away at everyone in the town. And you have a very young Steve McQueen who plays Steve.
Yeah, Steve!
Steve, who is disbelieved by everyone in the town who think that he's just crazy and making it up and he's a troublemaker and then becomes the hero of the hour and figures out how to actually try and defeat this giant blobby amoeba, which is actually made of silicone and red vegetable dye.
Oh, I love it. I love it. So, first of all, let me ask you, what do you think of The Blob? Are you a fan of it? Do you like it?
On rewatch of it for our discussion, I have to say I remembered it much more fondly when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. I think on a rewatch, because I know the sequel far better and I think it's much more fun and because obviously as I've aged, I've just seen so many more films and had so much more cultural input and seen so many more of those films like Invaders and Day the Earth Stood Still and Invaders from Mars and the original Thing and the remake, all of those, it just feels a little bit on the weaker side. I hate saying that because I had this with the Poltergeist films as well. I was like, oh, I love those films. And then I went back and started watching the sequels and went, oh, God, no, they're actually, they're really not very good. But there's lots to love about it, and its influence is still there and very much present. It's just I didn't quite remember it as fondly as I thought I might.
Yeah, I kind of agree with you. And I think particularly we are obviously going to be comparing it to the 80s version, and there's kind of no comparison, is there, really?
No.
I think that's the thing, and we'll get to the 80s version. But I enjoy this a lot, but with a lot of movies from this era, I kind of enjoy it more in a kind of historical context rather than... I'm not likely to just pop the blob on, I think. What a sentence to just kind of enjoy it, you know? Because it is... I wish there was more blob, Kat, to be honest. I wish there was a bit more blob. Like, there's a hell of a lot of just teenagers in cars arguing with, like, policemen and stuff like that.
Yeah, there's also teenagers arguing with other teenagers who then 2 minutes later turn out to be friends.
Yeah.
And it's just jovial. And it's like, oh, you're not threatening each other now. And also there's a very strange edit where Steve is supposed to be in the car with the girl he's romancing, Jane, throughout the whole movie. And they drive off in his lovely car. And then suddenly it cuts to them almost, it looks like they're just sat outside, not even in a car, continuing the conversation. It's like, oh, that's either framed badly or you've gone, oh, crap, I need to write this in now. Let's just sit you down and make it look like you're in the car. So it's it's kind of, it's a very strange one. I think the blob overall probably has about 5 minutes screen time throughout the whole film. And part of that, it's wrapped in a fabric and being viewed from afar and dropped in the Arctic at the end. So you're not even actually seeing the blob. You hear more about the blob, and you hear a lot about the blob and how the blob moves and reacts in that opening track, in the opening credits song, but you don't really see a lot of it. It's one of those sort of strange, almost invisible threats, but I guess that kind of plays into the paranoia of the time and some of the messaging of the film. So it doesn't have to be on screen at the time.
I found it really interesting, actually, that Kim Newman wrote a really good piece about it for Criterion. And he talked about how the blob is literally a red menace, right?
Yes,
it's this big red dangerous thing that's coming at America to get Americans. And that's really funny. But I love every moment when we see the blob in the film. I just wish that there was a bit more of it. And it's clearly a very low budget film when they did what they could with what they had, I guess. And it feels like there's a bit of filler with kind of just like the human drama that I was less into. And I guess like we should remember for context that movies like this were often played as half of a double feature, right?
As this was.
Exactly. This was played as a double feature with I Married a Monster from Outer Space.
That's I want to see that.
I know, right? I know. And like, I think that's the thing. Like, sometimes these movies didn't have to be that great on their own almost, did they, I think? And I suppose they didn't know that, you know, 70 years later, there'd be two people kind of trying to talk about it in this kind of like academic historic context, because it is like it was a movie for teenagers that made up half a night out in a cinema, wasn't it? That's the thing. So.
And it was also a film, bless it, it's something that almost not like a boast, but in the sort of historical notes of the making of the film, it came in under budget.
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, no shit it did. Honestly. Yeah, that came in under budget. Have you seen that movie? Of course that came in under budget. It's a bit of a strange one, but I still look at it fondly, but I was looking at my watch going, "Core, you've really stretched this out, guys." I think it's something like an hour and 20 minutes, but it felt like if you went to see that as a film at a film festival, you and I would be sat there going, that'd be done at 50 minutes. Just cut the fat off that, guys, honestly.
Yeah, agreed. I think it's 80 minutes long and it feels too long, doesn't it? That's a shame. Can we talk about, I mean, you mentioned this briefly a second ago, can we talk about the phenomenal opening song, though, to the which in my book, it automatically gives the film an extra 2 stars, you know, on its review, because what a song.
Beware of the blob, it creeps and leaps and glides and slides across the floor, right through the door and all around the wall. A splotch, a blotch, be careful of the blob.
The blob, It climbs up the doors and the walls and the floors. This is a song that was written by a young Burt Bacharach before Burt Bacharach was anyone. So, you know, if you think of all those great Dusty Springfield hits and Dionne yes. Warwick. And didn't he also write Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head? I think that's Burt Bacharach.
Yeah,
I have, yeah, I think so. You're going to have to check that before you you include this in a podcast.
Yeah.
But I'm pretty sure, you know, Burt Bacharach, such a legendary songwriter, wrote the opening song for The Blob. And it was a hit. I think it was like in the top 30 on the US Billboard charts. So
incredible. Incredible.
That, I mean, at the time, the song was probably, you know, there for wider consumption than the film was, which is kind of weird. But I get why I love a good plot song. I love films with plot songs.
Yeah.
I'm just not necessarily used to the plot songs being the opening song of the film, where it basically goes, it's an alien, it's over the walls and it's going to get you. And you're like, oh, you've told me the film. Okay.
It's so funny. But I really loved it. I think just straight away you get the sense of what this film is, and that it is just like a bit of fun, isn't it? That's the thing. Like like last week on the podcast, we talked about Invasion of the Body Snatchers, which is a much more kind of, it's an incredible film, right? But it's a very earnest, it takes itself very seriously. Like, it's not fucking around trying to be like a silly B-movie with a novelty song. It's like, that was taking aliens super seriously, right? Whereas this film is clearly not going for that. Like, I think it knows its audience, doesn't it, kind of thing? Like, it knows what it's going for.
Yeah, I think it's still tapping into all of that kind of Cold War paranoia, fear. Mm-hmm. Like you talked about, a fear of communism, a time of a fear of science and advancements and UFOs and alien invasion, but also weird stuff about gender roles changing in the 50s, what the new teenager is going to be. So it's all tapping into the same kind of stuff as a lot of those films.
Yeah.
But this is very much low budget, made in a different way, kind of outside the traditional old Hollywood studio system, just made differently for a different audience and targeting those kind of B-movie double feature experiences. So it's just got a different vibe to it. You know, they just wanted teenagers piling in their cars, going to have a good time and tell their friends about it. But at the same time, it's still a really interesting concept. And whether you look at things like, I think there's references in there in Monsters versus Aliens and Hotel Transylvania and the opening of Killer Clowns from Outer Space, there's a bit of a reference in there as well. So
yeah.
It's still massively influential, and in a way I quite like the fact that it's, you know, cheap and slightly tacky but much loved at the same time, but it isn't quite as good as some of the films that preceded it, like you just said, like Body Snatchers, which feels a bit more highbrow and there isn't any kind of playing for laughs. It's going for, here's what I'm trying to say with my film. This filmmaker was not doing that.
No, exactly. And I think, like, there is something about it that feels very much aimed at younger people, at teenagers, right? And this is what's really changed between the early 50s and the late 50s. There is this rise in teen culture, isn't there? The idea, I mean, this is fascinating, the idea that the teenager wasn't even really a thing, right, before the 1950s. It used to be that you were a child, and then you left school quite young often, and you went to work, often in factories with your parents and things like that. And it was kind of child to adult, and that was it. But there was a rise in compulsory education through the 20s, 30s, and into the 40s, which meant that young people were actually required to stay at school much longer to avoid them being put into child labour, essentially. So they stayed at school for a longer amount of time. So what you had was these kids between the ages of sort of 13 and 16, 17, that were physically older, that were sort of veering into adulthood, but were still in education. So they were in this weird in-between phase, not quite an adult and not a child. And this is where the idea of the teenager really came about. There was also a rise in, you know, the economy was booming in America in the 1950s. There was also a rise in cars, the amount of cars and the accessibility of cars. Teenagers had freedom. They had cars, but they may not actually have careers yet. So what you got was this kind of boom of teen culture, teen music, teen movies. This all coincided with the rise of the drive-in movie theater. And suddenly movie studios were, I think, very much aiming their movies at this new demographic, this group of not yet adults who had freedom. They had often their parents, you know, cash, disposable cash, but they had no responsibility and plenty of time to kill. And of course, with this growth in teen culture, in the idea of the teenager, came a kind of fear of the teenager as well. The older generations and, you know, more conservative generations feared that there was this kind of rise in juvenile delinquency as well. And there's this kind of us and them culture, more of a kind of generational divide that the adults and the parents and the grandparents just did not understand this new generation of teenagers that were emerging in the 1950s. So there was this kind of separation, I think, between generations. And that's something that's really, I think, brought to the fore in The Blob.
Would you think it was funny if your father, if Jane's father heard you were booked for reckless driving?
Okay, don't bring the fathers into this. I'll never do it again.
Do what again?
Huh?
Do what again?
Well, whatever you think I'm doing, Dave.
Like driving on the wrong side of the road?
Oh, so until this point, we've talked about alien films or horror films that focus on sort of older people, older adults, members of authority, you know, military, policemen, doctors with Invasion of the Body Snatchers, you know, even priests and pastors sometimes, you know. They are, the heroes of these films are in some way kind of older authoritative figures. Whereas here it's a teenager who no one believes and no one trusts initially, right? So there is definitely a kind of a change in who this movie is aimed at.
Yeah, it's kind of that sort of birth of rock and roll era, pop culture changes, post-war vibes, particularly in the States as well, a new breed of teenager being perhaps slightly less religion-focused, moral boundaries shifting a bit, all of that kind of thing. But yeah, there is a funny thing about watching this. I think Steve McQueen, who I love anyway, I mean, he's just such a screen icon. I think he was 28 when he made this film. And he looks 40.
He does!
And I think for most of his career, Steve McQueen just looked 40. He could have been 20 or I think he died at something like 50.
Yeah, he did, yeah.
You know, he looked the same throughout his whole career. Didn't seem to age to me. But it's like if you watch Grease, which is obviously set in the 50s in that kind of era, but made in the 70s. You know, they're trying to say that they're 18 and they still look about 40,
it's
all of them.
So funny. Yeah, you're so right.
It's a weird stylistic look, I think. Like if I look, I look back at pictures of my nan in the war and she used to say, oh, you know, I was 18. And I was like, really? You look 50. Your hair, your dress, you look... It's a very different kind of look. None of them feel or look like teenagers in this film to me.
No, you're so right. And that's been such a thing that's lasted for quite a long time. I reckon until really recently, like maybe the last 10 years, teenagers have always in Hollywood movies looked about 30 or upwards, right?
Yeah.
Even the movies when I was growing up, watching 90s teen movies, right? All the Screams and whatever else, you know, they all do not look like school kids, do they? And I wonder if that's got something to do with just making it slightly more palatable because, you know, in reality, teenagers are children, right? And like, it's amazing how many horror movies there are about children, about teenagers just getting fucked up by killers and monsters. And actually, I think if we really looked at what sort of 15, 16, 17, 18-year-olds looked like, we'd probably find that a lot more disturbing. But yeah, seeing Steve McQueen in this, it's kind of like, well, you don't feel too worried about Steve McQueen in The Blob, do you really?
No, it's just, it's also, he feels a little bit like he's not phoning it in, but he also doesn't have a huge amount to do.
No.
But he's the sort of badass, manly king of cool. So, I mean, what do you really want him to do? He's just such a great screen presence, but he's not exactly challenged in this.
No. And like, it's so on brand for him to, like, even the fact that it starts and he's in a car, right? And he's racing and it's like, oh my God, is this all Steve McQueen ever did? Because like, I didn't realize that kind of as early as this, even he has that kind of cool racing car driver kind of sort of image, right? Even in this movie, it's hilarious.
Just totally. And if you think that he then went on to do The Great Escape,
yeah,
and the Thomas Crown Affair, mm-hmm. Papillon, and it's just, and Bullet, it's just such a strange, but I think it's his first leading role in a film.
That's right, it was. I think before this he had just done TV and stuff like that,
yeah,
as well.
Yeah, just kind of TV, but yeah, it's I love that. I love that. Can you imagine walking into a casting afterwards? Steve, hi, how you doing? Okay, perfect. You're looking to move up to movies. Okay,
oh
what have
God.
You just done?
I know.
Yeah, I did a film about an amoebic blob eating people.
Well, again, like, it's the classic teen thing, isn't it? Where when you look at how many famous film stars started their career in low budget, like everything from Jennifer Aniston and Leprechaun to Kevin Bacon in Friday the 13th. Like, this has been such a tradition, and this is probably one of those earliest examples, right, of that like superstar who started in a silly B movie teen horror, right? And that's really fascinating. I think he was credited as Stephen McQueen in this as
he
well.
Was
which is hilarious as well. Yeah,
it's just, yeah, I love the opening credits, not just for the title song, but it's a kind of weird psychedelic red squirrely circle that just is quite hypnotic and moves around and around, and it sets up a completely different kind of film for me. It's like, oh, this is a kind of, oh, but now it's B movie horror, but now it's not, now we're trying to be serious. It's kind of weird. But the director afterwards, I think, went on to basically, his next big thing was Dinosaur, another kind of creature movie, and yeah. It looks from his IMDb like that was kind of it, which is,
yeah, that's kind of sad. I mean, especially considering, okay, yeah, The Blob isn't perfect, but it is a film that has really stayed in everyone's, like, everyone knows The Blob regardless of like how good it is. It seems to be a film that has like stood the test of time in that everyone knows it and knows what it is, don't they? And that in itself is quite an amazing feat, I think.
Yeah, I think so. And also, if, yeah, just thinking about other films that it's influenced and other things that reference it, I mean, I sort of, do you remember Attack of the Killer Tomatoes?
Yes!
I mean, that feels very Blob,
yes,
to me.
Yeah.
I think of that quite fondly, and I just wonder, you know, would that exist without The Blob? Would some trauma exist without The Blob? And I don't think so, actually. That basically sums it up.
Yeah, trauma, absolutely. You mentioned The Stuff too, right?
Yeah,
I mean, The Stuff.
Oh, God, I love that.
100% influenced by The Blob, yeah. And, you know, that's it. It's a certain type of alien monster movie that is not, it's not that kind of, because also this is, you know, this is one of the few that's in colour, like that real Technicolor look as well. A lot of them, like Invasion of the Body Snatchers, they had that much more kind of shadowy, noir-y kind of look. And also these aren't people dressed as aliens in like rubber suits as well. This is an entirely different type of thing. So I think there's a lot about it that makes it kind of really stand out maybe from the slew of other 50s alien movies at the time.
Oh,
too.
Yeah. It's also, yeah, it's barely on screen.
Yeah.
Whereas it's quite easy to put a man in a costume.
Yeah.
Or say, you know, I'm a body snatcher, I'm not who I was.
Yes.
Or like The Invaders, that another Larry Cohen piece, obviously, because he wrote and directed The Stuff and then created The Invaders.
Mm-hmm.
Their whole thing was, we're aliens, but we look like people.
Yeah.
So it's
perfect.
Like, okay, they're going to be on screen all the time.
Yes.
Great.
Yes.
Not a lot of makeup going on there.
Totally. It's totally.
So, yeah, The Stuff kind of, not The Stuff, The Blob, mm-hmm. In the 50s Blob, The Blob kind of becomes this sort of force that everyone's scared of but doesn't particularly see very much. But then there's loads of films like that. There's loads of great horror films where you don't really see much of the monster. I mean, Alien is a great example of that.
Exactly. Yeah, no, there's a huge tradition of that, isn't there? But I think maybe from something like this, when there's sort of so little else going on, you do just want to see The Blob, don't you? That's the difference. But let's talk about
the pacing of it is slightly painful.
It's just a movie where that clearly wasn't a priority for them, is the other stuff. Whereas, yeah, you know, if you look at a film like Alien, where it's like, sort of, there's so much more tension and character based stuff, isn't there? And even a movie like The Mist, which we're covering, about those people stuck in that supermarket, right?
There's a link here. We'll get to it, but all I was going to say was that
is a film that is so terrifying, not just because of the monsters, but because of all the human drama going on in amongst it too, right? And like, that is maybe something that is missing from this movie. But, you know, it was made by a bunch of people with no money and, you know, outside of Hollywood, so whatever. What do you think of the way the blob itself looks then? Well, we do see glimpses of it. Obviously, we see it initially and it kind of wraps itself around that man's hand, and then it kind of gets bigger and bigger every time we see it, right? What do you think of the blob itself?
If I had grown up in a completely different era, mm-hmm. as in if I had grown up in the 50s or 60s and I had seen the original blob, mm-hmm. I would go, oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
But I grew up in the 80s. You know, when special effects just went into a completely different era. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, as a baby born on video nasties and raised to kind of enjoy slightly more sophisticated special effects, even in cheap, low-budget flicks,
yeah.
compared to that,
yeah.
it doesn't really compare. I think mm-hmm. if I'd grown up in a different time, I'd have been like, oh, my God, that's scary, that's amazing. Yeah. I mean, I still love Ray Harryhausen films. I really, really do. Things
oh, yeah.
like Jason and the Argonauts and just, oh, my God, just Clash of the Titans. I love all of those films and Sinbad and those effects. But these are not a patch or anything in comparison to that. And then when you start to move through the 70s, 80s mm-hmm. onwards, it's just too... I just can't look at it and go, that's a great special effect. There's just nothing there for me.
It's really interesting. I do kind of like the way it moves. And obviously, like, it's not... It is just an inanimate thing, right? It's
yeah.
it's like, what is it? Silicon? You said what it was. It's
yeah,
like
silicon and red vegetable dye. And as it eats people, it just gets redder and redder. Like you said,
yeah.
like Kim Newman's, you know, it's basically that red wave growing and spreading.
Yeah, this big red terror just growing, exactly,
yeah.
and devouring things. But, you know, what they did was they just sort of filmed it just like drooping off tables and things, right? I mean, it's literally... It's gravity, essentially, that is making it move. So they filmed it sort of slowly kind of making its way, dripping off a table onto a floor or something. And they just used that movement to kind of then make it move across streets or on top of diner roofs or whatever. I mean, like, that in itself is pretty cool, I think, you know?
Do you know what? I think it's cool because it is that representation of what the film is trying to tell you it's about.
Uh-huh.
There's so many references in there where... it's not Steve McQueen, it's one of the supporting characters, goes to a party and everyone's drunk and they open the door and he starts trying to warn them
mm-hmm.
and they're going, we're scared, the British are coming.
Yeah,
and then
yeah,
he
yeah.
shuts the door and then there's another part where there's this big air raid warning and everyone's running about like a bomb's about to drop. So there's that kind of fear again. And then... there's another line where they say, how do you get people to protect themselves from something that they don't believe in?
Uh-huh, yeah.
So there's all of that kind of messaging that's in there. And so the blob is just kind of there to be a supporting threat for all of those themes and kind of drive that weird 50s anxiety and panic forward. So it kind of moves... as it's telling you it's going to move, as those themes move and that sort of red menace moves kind of slowly but surely, and
yeah.
it's going to get you. It's just going to get you. It doesn't just have to engulf people in an instant. It's going to silently creep up and sneak up on you. So in a way, it kind of makes sense. But the remake...
Mm-hmm.
Way different.
Has an entirely different MO. Yeah,
yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Different
no.
kind of monster.
Completely.
Great monster.
Completely, yeah. But I do kind of like it. I like it whenever we see it in this film. I think that there are sort of... And like we said, there's a lot of filler in this movie, but there are those key set pieces that sort of still look great. I still love the scene in the movie theatre. And again, I
yeah.
think there's something kind of really...
That's a good
there's
movie.
Something really
yeah,
fun,
good
right,
scene.
About this idea that... This is one of the very first films that felt like it was very obviously aiming itself at a teen audience. It's about teenagers. And the fact that it actually kind of has its final act in a movie theatre while people are watching a horror film too, right? And like, there's something really cool and sort of meta about that is done so much in the 80s and 90s, but again, this is probably a really early example of that idea of kind of, you know, but horror with horror and everything.
Yeah, and I think what's, yeah, you know, they're at a midnight movie screening.
Yeah, exactly.
God, what is it? What is it they're watching? Yeah, Midnight Spook Show.
Brilliant.
With Daughter of Horror plus Bela Lugosi.
Yes, Bela Lugosi, exactly, yeah. So it's kind of harking back to an era before them, isn't it? That's the thing.
It is.
Yeah.
It totally is. But what's weird is if you watch the scene where they're all running away from the Colonial Theatre, you see the elderly, you see little kids running away.
Yeah.
You're like, is this a midnight movie showing? Is anyone checking these tickets? I mean, yeah. what was going on with this? It's just like, it feels like they've just went, everyone get your family, just run out of this theatre. But I love that. I mean, I used to sneak into films that I was too young to see when I was a kid going to the cinema. But it is a kind of strange moment of, oh, it's not midnight. This is probably 6 p.m. on a dark night in Pennsylvania. Yeah. And you've just invited everyone to come along and be an extra in the scene. But I love it. But at the same time, though there's that scene in the movie theatre, I get the impression that lots of people will have seen this at drive-ins.
Yes, yeah.
So that's the weird
that's
consumption
a good point.
Of it, I suppose.
Yeah.
Lots of people running away from movie theatres when really the teenagers super interested in this were necking in cars.
Yeah,
when
that's
they
it.
Were watching it.
That's it. And it's so true about the, you know, kids. I mean, kids probably snuck in to watch The Blob too, right? And then that's probably quite a scary thing to see, that you go watch this movie and you see children being attacked in this horror movie theatre and kind of running for their lives afterwards. I mean, it's quite fun. I really like that about it. And again, I kind of like that sort of like the way it sort of oozes through those grates from the projection room and everything.
It's lovely.
It's very cool. It's very cool.
And there are lots of little elements that then carry through to the remake as mm-hmm. well.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Even though they spin on it, you know, or they improve on it, they still use it as a reference point and a real influence. And I do think that if you watch a trailer for The Blob and it gets referenced quite a lot, everyone uses everyone running away from the Colonial Theatre in terror, in
yes.
absolute terror, and the Blob like coming out the doors and stuff. And it's a lot of fun.
It's kind of the image that I think of when I think of like 50s horror, right? You think of like giant atomic monsters, or you think of like giant aliens and people running through the streets screaming. It's like that. It's like Godzilla and stuff, right? Those
yes.
sorts of movies is exactly what I think of when I think of The Blob. It's that like quintessential 50s alien invasion movie in a way. And again, like it's not the best one, like we've said, but there's something about it that is in some ways even more iconic than like the 50s body snatchers in a way, like visually and everything. And that's really interesting that it's just kind of stayed in our subconscious, you know, all this time.
Well, Mike, now here's the thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not saying the thing as in the thing, because
the thing.
Obviously
yeah.
the thing.
Yeah.
But the thing about the Blob
mm-hmm.
is there is Blobfest every year.
Oh my God, exactly, right?
There is a festival every year dedicated to the Blob in Pennsylvania, in the Colonial Theatre, which is where they shot that scene, and it was one of the main shooting locations. A Blobfest.
I love
it. You can buy tickets for Blobfest, Mike.
I love it. I mean, that's the thing. There you go, you see. If we want to talk about films that have had a cultural impact and that have staying power, say what you like about The Blob. I mean, there's still a festival in its name, you know, today. That's really cool, you know? And, like, clearly this movie has such a sort of cult appeal. Like, yeah, it's a bit silly, but it has such cult love for it, doesn't it? And that in itself is quite great. I love that.
I mean, here's the thing, Mike, right?
Mm-hmm.
How many people love The Room?
Exactly that. Exactly.
How many people would still pay and watch Tulpa?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep.
I mean, there are so many films that I could name now, and everyone would be like, don't say that that's like The Room or Tulpa. But every, you know, there are so many films that you're like, oh, it's kind of bad, but I love it. But The Blob isn't like that. It's way more than that. It has way more influence and way more going on for it. It's just on rewatch. And if you're looking for something that has loads of depth and loads of character in it, it's not that kind of movie.
No.
And no one thought about it enough.
Do you know what? You'd probably have so much fun watching it at a midnight screening when you were a bit pissed. Again, it's like, it's all context, isn't it? I think us watching it in our living rooms on our TVs during lockdown, it's just not going to, it wasn't designed for that, was it? That's the thing, you know? So it's interesting to sort of think about the context for that.
Do you know what though as well? Last year at Fright Fest was a great little film called, you're going to totally disagree with me on this, called Cyst, which I really liked. Oh, I really liked it, yeah. Cyst. And The Blob reminds me, and Cyst reminds me of The Blob, and Blob, The Blob reminds me of Cyst.
Yes.
There's quite a lot there going on in terms of style, mm-hmm. and silliness, and Cyst being a bit of a B-movie tribute, and... The Cyst is this thing that... I don't want to ruin it for everyone. Anyway, listeners, check out Cyst. It's Cyst. Really lovely. It's great. It's kind of gross as well. I love it.
Brilliant. Well, yeah, I mean, like, Fright Fest is filled with movies like The Blob, right? Like, kind of modern equivalents of The Blob. Like, those sorts of... And I mean that as a compliment, but, like, kind of fun midnight movie sort of... B-movie schlocky kind of, like, crowd-pleasers, yeah. I suppose, you know? Yeah, that's exactly what those sorts of nights out in cinemas are for, I suppose.
God, what are they? It's been so long, I don't even remember.
I know, that's it. This film kind of made me miss being in a cinema, that's the thing. So there you go. Anything else you want to mention on the 50s Blob before we wrap up and move on to the 80s Blob?
Don't you find it sort of weird, the ending?
Yeah, what, when they just sort of freeze it and shove it in the North Pole?
But you just have the copper in the car talking to someone from the US government. Yeah. And it's about 5 minutes of exposition of him basically basically talking on the phone to nobody.
Yeah.
Because, listener, there is nobody on the end of that phone that he's holding. Yeah. About how he's going to solve this problem, which is, we're going to put it in the Arctic.
Yeah.
And then suddenly, oh, okay, it's frozen for a bit. Cut mm-hmm. to something wrapped in some kind of fabric from afar and dropped in yeah. the Arctic with a big, massive question mark on the end.
I
and
love
you're like,
that.
Okay.
The end.
So there isn't really an ending.
Yeah, I know. I love that. That's kind of fun, though. I like that kind of, it's still out there, it's still coming to get you kind of vibe, isn't it, I suppose, which is kind of fun. I mean, these movies all do feel like they have that kind of very abrupt ending. Like, even Invasion of the Body Snatchers last week, we talked about how they kind of had to tack this ending on where it's like, oh, everything's going to be okay. And, you know, obviously they changed that for the 70s version, but for the 50s version, and it's probably partly to do with the Hays Code and everything else, but they kind of had to they had to just kind of shove on these happy endings, didn't they, I think? And often they feel very abrupt and sort of out of nowhere. I think it's hilarious, the ending to this, where they're suddenly like, ah, cold, freeze it, get rid of it, and they just fly it to the Arctic and just dump it, and that's it.
Yeah, but there's also, like, it's not a hero moment for anyone. It's not a hero moment for Steve McQueen. It's not a hero moment for the copper.
It's no a hero one moment is victorious. For the, it's the American government, isn't it? That's the thing. It's like, the American government or the American military or whatever will come and save the day from the evil red terror.
But you know that there was a sequel directed by Larry Hagman.
Yes, I've not seen it. Have you?
No.
No.
I didn't even know it. Oddly, not that I know everything, but I've had, you know, quite a geekily obsessive kind of existence usually. But I was like, Son of the Blob? What? Larry mm-hmm. Hagman is in JR. I was like, yeah, JR directed this film. Like, what a weird thing.
That is weird.
That weirder is really things weird. Happened, Mike. Weirder things happen in the Arctic.
Maybe one day I'll check out the sequel. But yeah, it kind of also feels a bit like, and this came, what, 1958? So very, basically around the same time as those sort of William Castle sort of movies as well, right? Which again, they're a bit naff when you watch them now at home because it really feels like they were so designed to be, you know, woo, skeletons and electrodes in seats and all of that kind of stuff, right? It's very much of that era, I think.
But I think there's always a thing where with films like that, you have to look at them fondly because mm-hmm. if we hadn't have had them, we wouldn't have had the journey through the rest of cinema to things Absolutely. That scare the pants off me now. Well, things like them, which is actually telly, not Jesus. Even cinema.
Well, what is fascinating, and this will lead us into the next film, but like what is fascinating is that these movies in the 50s, for better or worse, they all inspired these incredible remakes that came 20 or 30 years later, whether it's The Thing, The Fly, Invasion of the Body Snatchers. All of them started off as these sort of 50s B-movies, and then they became these masterpieces as well. So whatever it was about these movies, the stories inspired a whole generation of filmmakers that obviously grew up when they were kids watching these at the movie theatre, right? And that, and it, so they all are like, they're so culturally important, I think, you know.
And I think what's really interesting is, God, don't at me, people, but The Thing, I think, is John Carpenter's best film.
Oh, 100% agree, yeah.
And I think The Fly, and I'm such a Cronenberg fan, like I'm such a Cronenberg fangirl, mm-hmm. It's really sad, but I think The Fly is his best film.
Yeah, 100%.
And when you consider that and the Invasion of the Body Snatchers 70s remake, I think is way better.
Phenomenal. I was speechless at how good that film was. It was incredible.
And
yeah.
That I can still, I mean, I've got the beautiful tin. It's an Arrow release. God, I love it. I love it so much. And the Blob remake is not just better than the original, but I still think a cracking film from the 80s. So all of those films just inspired, like you said, all of those really cool filmmakers to go and make, reimagine something in a time when reimaginings and remakes weren't that common. I think the only other, it's not even a remake, it's a sequel, but it feels in part like a remake. The only other one from that period that I think is great is Psycho 2.
Yes.
And that's another great film. Incredible. And better than what precedes it. Everyone's going to hate me because ditched Hitchcock.
Did you think Psycho 2 is better than Psycho?
Yeah.
That is bold, but I like it. I like it.
Do you know
it.
What? I'm going to say, at me, do what you want.
No, I think there's a hell do of it. A lot of love for Psycho 2. Like that, and it's brilliant in a very different way. I mean, you almost can't compare those two films because they're so different, but they're
for
so
me,
fun in their own right.
It's more scary.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And Norman is driven mad.
Yeah.
He's driven back. I love that film. Yeah. I love that film. What an incredible script that is.
Yeah, and
that's just an incredible script.
I think what we had was like, yeah, people that grew up on those movies that thought, yeah, those movies had incredible ideas, but maybe, you know, they did what they could with practical effects and people in rubber alien suits and whatever else. But now we in the 1980s have all of these other amazing things at our disposal. Let's make those again, but up the ante, right? And that's what led to all those incredible, incredible remakes. Yeah. Hello, everybody. Just interrupting this week's episode momentarily to thank this week's sponsor. That's $20 Patreon subscriber, Liberty. A huge thank you to Liberty. Liberty, thank you so much for all of your support throughout these last couple of months for the podcast. Liberty sent me a really lovely message. She said, "Hi, Mike. I am so happy to be a sponsor and support your work. I've literally only gotten into horror films in the last 2 years, and I'm now obsessed with consuming as much content and education as I can, and your podcast has been a pleasure to listen to. I don't really have anything particular to plug other than my Letterboxd account, which is at Liberty M. I am most definitely no real critic, and I don't always post serious reviews, but I do compile every single horror movie I watch for the first time in lists for each year, and also compile franchise rankings, so if you could maybe give a shout out to that, I would love to have more people to interact with." Well, thank you so much, Liberty. And of course, now I am extremely curious to see how you've ranked and how you've rated certain movies. So I am literally going onto your Letterboxd account right now. Ah, now you've got a list here. New spooky movies from 2021. So Liberty has ranked the best classic horrors and thrillers that she's seen so far this year. Number one, she's got Night of the Living Dead, her favourite horror movie that she's revisited this year. That is, I mean, a classic. You can't really argue with that. She gave it 4.5 stars. Easily one of the best horror movies I've ever seen. This was a beautifully shot film. The use of the weird camera angles and the shadows are incredible. I'm personally not a huge fan of monster movies, but I loved this. Incredible. You've also got The Texas Chainsaw Massacre as your second favourite. Now, I hate to disagree with you, Liberty, but Texas Chainsaw Massacre is the greatest horror movie ever made, so it couldn't possibly be in second place. But fair enough, you gave that 4.5 stars as well. You've also got Suspiria, Wreck, Evil Dead 2, A Nightmare on Elm Street, Possessor, Freaky, The Wicker Man, and Army of Darkness all in your top 10. How exciting for you, Liberty, that you get to watch all of these horror films for the first time. I am now officially following you on Letterboxd because I love, I especially love hearing from kind of new or new-ish horror fans who are watching and going through the classics for the first time. So if you want to follow Liberty, please do. If you're on Letterboxd, follow her at Liberty M and give her some recommendations. There's probably classics out there that Liberty hasn't yet seen. Get in touch with her, let her know what you think of her reviews, and recommend some classic titles that she needs to check out and add to her list. Okay, one more time, a huge thank you to the lovely listener and $20 Patreon subscriber, Liberty. Liberty, thank you so much. And don't forget, if you want to become an official Evolution of Horror sponsor, get your own little segment in the middle of a podcast episode such as this one, and get treated to loads of bonus content. We're talking hundreds of bonus episodes now, and a new one every single week, then sign up now. Patreon.com/evolutionofhorror. That's patreon.com/evolutionofhorror. Okay, let's return to my discussion with Cat Davies as we move from 1958 to 1988 to discuss Chuck Russell's remake of The Blob.
If it had a mind, you could reason with it. If it had a body, you could shoot it. If it had a heart, you could kill it. Now, man is no longer the supreme being on this planet.
The organism is growing at a geometric rate. By all accounts, it's at least 1,000 times its original mass.
Nobody believes me about what happened tonight.
What did happen?
You were there, you saw.
Plasmic life form that hunts its prey. Predator.
I want that organism alive.
I think you ticked it off.
The Blob. Terror has no shape.
Cat, I can't believe I'm saying this out loud, but this was the first time I'd ever seen it. I had never seen The Blob remake
This
before.
Really surprised, because this is like totally your thing, right?
Yeah.
This is
I think it's partly because it's never had a decent release in the UK. Like, I've never been able to get hold of it. I only got hold of it during lockdown because I now have a multi-region Blu-ray player, and so I was able to order a region one version, which actually you and James told me to get. You were like,
yes,
you've got to get yourself
a multi-region.
Because
we have it.
Yeah. So I did. And so, but like, I don't know, for whatever reason, growing up, I was never able to see this movie. It just passed me by. I'd never got on the chance to see it, and I'd heard so much good stuff. And I don't know, as much as like there are a certain group of horror fans that do shout about it, also you don't read about it that often. Like, I don't know, like in lists of like greatest horror movies, and you always see The Thing and you always see The Fly, but you never see The Blob pop up as much as you should, I think. Do you know what I mean? Which is weird.
Yeah, it's a little bit, it's a bit more under the radar. And
yeah.
I remember our local video shop having like a poster for it in the window.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of how I knew of it as a kid. And we used to go and rent like 5 videos for £5.
Oh,
and a
those
new
were
release.
The days.
God.
Yeah.
A new release for like £2.50. And my mum and dad always loved horror. So I think I watched that more than CBBC. I didn't know the presenters of the broom cupboard, but I knew what was going on in terms of the new rentals in Roxy Video.
Yes.
So yeah, that's kind of how I became familiar with it, and I just always really, really liked it, and it's something, yeah, we revisit it every now and again, but watching it again more recently, I just thought, God, when you reappraise it, the effects are great. It's brutal, actually. It's far more body horror than the original. Way more. There's clearly that influence of the time, mm-hmm. and better special effects. And there's a female protagonist in this. She has some agency. She's mm-hmm. sometimes, you know, saved by... We'll probably come on to him, but are not quite so great male lead. But it's still kind of her film. And there's a much more concrete ending. And there's an actual third act in this film. And yeah. the script is just... But in terms of a synopsis for this one, mm-hmm. it's much more led by that female lead who is a girl called Meg, who's like a cheerleader, played by Shawnee Smith, who, of mm-hmm. course, is a scream queen anyway from like Saw 2, 3 and 4.
Yeah.
Who she never ages.
She's
the same. Another one
yeah. Yeah.
who looks the same.
Yeah. Yeah.
No matter what decade it is, it's kind of like, is she a body snatcher or something?
I think so.
She looks amazing.
Yeah.
And yeah, there's the meteorite that hits. And again, it's this big amoeba that starts assimilating and eating its way through a town. This time, I think at least it's shot in Louisiana, even if they don't explicitly mm-hmm. say that it's Louisiana. So a completely different sort of time. But the costumes still look kind of 50s. It's yeah. still got a 50s look and vibe to it.
Yep.
Which is a really interesting choice. And some of the morals of the 50s where a teenage boy goes and buys condoms.
Mm-hmm.
And he's kind of embarrassed about it. And it feels like, oh, you young rapscallion going and buying condoms. Whereas a teenager in the 80s, everyone was like, no, do go and buy condoms. There's no yes. shame. We want you to do that. Don't get somebody pregnant.
Yes, yes.
But it's so great. And I'm going to say it now.
Mm-hmm.
It's a script by Frank Darabont.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he also wrote The Fly 2.
He did.
The Mist.
Oh, what a film.
But also wrote and directed The Shawshank Redemption and The Green Mile.
Yeah.
And so really in that sort of Stephen King horror world as well, and created The Walking Dead, the TV series. So yeah. Do you know what? I'm going to say this. I think that Frank Darabont, of the last 30 years, one of the most important figures in horror.
Yeah, I'm with you, definitely.
And I don't think he gets any of that praise, really. It's just like, oh, isn't The Shawshank Redemption fantastic? It's like, yeah, but what about all these other things?
Well, and also Chuck Russell, right, as well. I mean, actually, because I think Frank Darabont might have also been one of several writers for Dream Warriors as well.
Yes, they did, yeah. They were a team working
and,
together, that's
And obviously
right.
Chuck Russell directed Dream Warriors, one of the greatest movies ever, as we both know, right? Phenomenal. And Chuck Russell, yeah, just like very small filmography. I sent it to you last
Tiny.
Night because I was like, holy shit, look at this guy. His first three films were Dream Warriors, then The Blob, then The Mask. I was like, that in itself, it's like any filmmaker should be proud to have three movies that good in their whole filmography, right? And this was his first three films. It's amazing.
I mean,
like, that is amazing.
Even one.
Yeah.
Even one.
Yeah,
I
one
mean,
of those
that's
three.
That's a dream.
Yeah.
But you're right, it is a tiny filmography.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's just interesting that two of those films were with Frank Darabont.
Uh-huh, yeah.
And so there is that element of, oh my God, no doubt that they're cracking films in terms of direction, but it does make you wonder, did Frank Darabont just go in a different direction and did they just kind of need that partnership to really keep inventing? But then some of that is also down to the projects people get offered.
Yeah,
as
totally.
Well, and who's in vogue and who's not at a particular point. It is kind of weird to go from the Dream Warriors and the Blob to the Mask. I mean, the Mask is kind of strange and larger than life, like a big, almost Freddy Krueger type character and an effect
in
the movie.
Yeah, yeah. The Mask has a certain...
Completely different audience, though. It's kind of strange.
It is a different audience, but at the same time, I can sort of see the through line. It's got that kind of, you know, crazy but quite revolutionary special effects, but also like... kind of wacky but scary at the same time. Like, I was a child when I first saw The Mask, and it really freaked me out as a kid. And there is something, it's not horror, but it's almost like horror adjacent, The Mask, in a weird way, especially when you're young and you watch it, because it's so weird and out there. So I can sort of see it, but just like, what... they're all just so striking and colourful and creative and fun, those movies, aren't they, as well, you know? I love them.
Yeah, you're right. I think it's the mask is borderline acceptable horror for kids.
It is, kind of. It is, yeah. And there's some pretty dark stuff in it as well. So it's the sort of film that you feel like doesn't really exist anymore, that's sort of a family film, but it's got some quite fucked up weird stuff in it as well. And yeah. Like, it's got some really nasty horror in it as well, but it was sort of a PG and families went to see it. And you don't really get that anymore, but it was that so much, again, of the 80s and 90s, that kind of thing. Yeah,
that is an interesting one. That really is an interesting one. Mm. But I think that The Blob was funded as well, based on the success of Dream Warriors.
Yeah, yeah.
Isn't that kind of... I mean, Dream Warriors.
Well, that's it. Like, he made like the best, you know, the best Nightmare on Elm Street, one of the best horror sequels, kind of full stop. And then he got to do this. And he was, of course, apparently a huge fan of the original 50s one. And I think you're right. Like, and we'll talk about, obviously, the practical effects and how good this film is in terms of its look. But I want to ask you, first of all, about the... like, because you said Frank Darabont, right? And I think mm-hmm. the writing is part of what makes this film so good. Because, like we said, the 50s one is really fun, but really it could have been written in about 5 minutes, probably, in terms of the characters, right? Whereas this movie, straight away, you're like, okay, I get it. You've got the bad boy biker. You've got the awkward scene with buying condoms in the chemist. You've got a female protagonist who you actually like, and she's got a family who you like. And there's... all of these characters, you've got the cop who's kind of fancies the woman that works in the cafe and the diner. And like, every character has something about them, right? Every character has a dimension. And you're like, oh, and that is what links us, you know, Frank Darabont, The Mist, Shawshank. It's like, oh, every character has a bit of humanity to them in this film. And that really helps, I think, you know?
I think he writes characters extremely well, even if he has a source text.
Yeah.
To base it on. Everyone has their own little plot line and their own world and their own quirks and things that make them so much more human. And the sheriff, that's Jeffrey DeMunn, mm-hmm. who's also in The Walking Dead and loads of other Frank Darabont stuff.
He's in loads of stuff. Yeah, yeah.
I just love him. And he's done that with... That's kind of his sort of repertory company, I suppose, that he takes from project to project, whether he writes it or directs it or whatever. But they're just lovely and really sweet. And the families are really nice. And do you know what? That blob is so mean and aggressive. And the blob is a proper character in this film.
Yes.
It's a proper character. It has no mercy. Mm-hmm. It wants to eat. It's gonna gobble you all up. Mm-hmm. It's going to take the town on. Mm-hmm. It even attacks a kid.
Yes.
It attacks a kid.
Yeah.
There's a scene in a sewer where Shawnee Smith and her brother and who's a little teenage boy and his friend, they're trying to escape the blob through the sewer and they get attacked. And at first you don't really see the blob. It's just all implied and it's in the water. And they're trying to get up this fire escape. And it pulls this kid. Mm-hmm. And she dives in the water to save this kid. And then suddenly he tries to escape and pushes through the blob and it's pretty grotesque and you're like, holy fuck, the blob is gonna kill kids.
That
enters a new realm of shocker.
Totally. It's brutal. It is absolutely brutal. Like, I was just knocked out by the sequences in this film when the blob kills people. It's so good. I don't even know where to start. Like, the moment when it pulls that guy's hand down the plug hole.
Oh, it's just brilliant. Phenomenal. Yeah. But it doesn't just pull his hand. It completely sucks him down the plug hole.
It's just incredible, isn't it? I couldn't believe... I was blown away by the practical effects, the special effects in this movie. It feels really, and we'll talk about this as we go, but it feels really like it owes more of a debt to John Carpenter's The Thing. Even this 1978 Invasion of the Body Snatchers, David Cronenberg's The Fly. It's that really, really visceral body horror that we get here, right? So many stunning effects. The effects were done by Tony Gardner, who this was one of his earliest projects, I believe, but he would go on to do loads of movies. Army of Darkness, Zombieland, Seed of Chucky, Freaky, this year's Freaky. He's done a lot of horror movies since, but it just looks incredible, doesn't it? I was gobsmacked.
It's and that sort of first opening attack mm-hmm. On the guy who finds the blob inside the meteorite, and it's just as the original, it attaches itself to his hand. But then when he's in the hospital, there's that sort of body horror effect where clearly something's growing through his throat, and then they pull back the sheet and the lower half of his body's gone.
Yeah.
Like, where's it gone? It's just gone. You see guts and everything. You're like, whoa, okay, this is a real thing. This is a proper body horror film.
Yeah. And because at that point, you know, the teenagers are kind of being slightly ignored, aren't they? And that's something that's sort of carried over from the 50s version, but they've been trying to get the attention of that doctor who's played by Jack Nance from Twin Peaks, but he completely ignores them, doesn't he? Did you recognise him as well?
I did. I sat there and I was like, I didn't know that was Jack Nance until I rewatched and went, that's Jack Nance. Razorhead.
From Razorhead. Razorhead, another kind of classic sort of body horror, practical effects horror, right, as well. But yeah, there is that feeling, that there's that connection, I think, between the 50s and the 80s. And I don't know if it was maybe because of sort of Reaganism and making everything in America very, very conservative again, like it was in the 50s maybe or something, because it kind of feels like it's come full circle in its values maybe or something. But there's that feeling that like the teenagers are sort of being isolated by grown-ups in 80s movies, you know, like no one ever believes them. That's what all the Nightmare on Elm Street films are about too, right? And Dream Warriors, it's like these kids are alone and no one believes them. And it feels like there's a lot of that in this movie too initially. You know, they go to the police and the police don't like the teenagers. They hate the main kid played by Kevin Dillon because he's like a bad boy.
But he's not.
The receptionist at the hospital just kind of ignores them and fobs them off. And like, yeah, no one really listens to these teenagers until it's too late kind of thing. Which I suppose that was carried over from the Steve McQueen version. But yeah, I kind of liked that about it as well. But yeah, the gruey effect in this when the blob starts sort of chomping down on people, it's just so good. It looks amazing.
And it feels like that team of Chuck Russell and Frank Darabont and Tony Gardner, it just feels like such a great team.
Yeah.
It feels like they all needed each other to make a really, really great film. I don't think without any of them it would be quite the same film.
No, it's true. It's true.
But it's such a cracking combo for something that was a much more modest box office 80s horror hit, because you know it wasn't one of those cinema fodders that just would take 20 30 40 50 million and fine, it's done, because it didn't do as well as that.
But it was
much better made than some of the ones that were slightly more successful.
Do you think it was because it was called The Blob? I mean, do you think people were just like straight away assumed, oh, this is just some like shitty B movie remake? Like, I wonder if people just didn't initially give it the credit that it deserves.
Well, I'll be honest. Here's the thing.
Yeah.
When you hear a movie called The Blob, I know what I think it's about.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you know what you're in for. Yeah.
I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
And I think I'm pretty sure I believe when I was a kid that The Blob also meant periods when I was a kid.
Yeah, on The Blob.
So surfing the crimson wave, that only came with Clueless.
Yeah.
So I'm pretty sure that The Blob meant periods. So there is that kind of, do you want to come and see The Blob with me, darling? Not quite sure, actually.
Not my ideal date night, to be honest, darling. No.
Don't know. No. You're all right. I don't know. I think... You know, some of those remakes were much... Well, if you look at it, though, even The Thing wasn't even a hit.
No, it wasn't. No, big flop. It's really interesting, that. Yeah.
And almost killed his career. Massive, massive flop.
And again, maybe that has something to do with the fact that it was called The Thing. I don't know, like, there's that association, I think, that you don't expect these films maybe to be taken as seriously as they are, almost.
Because they're related as well to those old movies.
Yeah, they're linked to those old movies. The titles sound like kind of B-movie titles, you know, and they're just... Horror had changed a bit. Everyone was watching slashers and kind of nastier stuff, maybe.
That's true, yeah. The slasher era was in full force. More than in full swing. It was getting to a point where that was getting old hat, wasn't it?
Yeah,
With some of the Nightmare sequels towards the back end of the 80s.
And yeah, exactly.
Friday the 13th was
on part 8 or something by that point. Yeah.
Do you know what? Do you remember, I think we've spoken about this before, some of those sequels are great for Friday the 13th.
Oh, yeah.
It's like the alternate ones.
Oh,
if
yeah.
you go with the even numbers, the odd ones, it's like... Oh,
totally. The even ones are great. Like 6 and 8, Jason Takes Manhattan. There's some good ones in there. There's some good ones. But yeah, you know, so for whatever reason, maybe those titles just put people off, I think. And I can kind of see that, like, before watching them. I don't think I expected The Blob to be quite as brilliant as that was, actually. That not just the practical effects, but also the writing, the quality of the directing, the performances, you know, it kind of is, every element is brilliant, I think. And like that is...
It's great.
Yeah.
I do think it's a spectacular film. And I also think the ending is one of the most visually beautiful endings for a horror film.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So basically, Shawnee Smith and the town, obviously they've worked out that the blob itself is not a fan of the cold, mm-hmm. much like me, actually. Not yeah. just when on the blob, but just generally just not time. A fan of the cold. So that's why I can't live in this country for the rest of my life. So they start using fire extinguishers, and then I think it's a snow truck. Like, who has a snow truck? But I love the fact that they run off and get a snow truck from the middle of nowhere, and they freeze it. And yeah. they literally freeze it, and it breaks into lots of little pieces. God, it looks like thousands of pieces, doesn't it? And then this snowmobile just sends snow all over the town.
Mm-hmm.
And you've still got these rocks that are all broken up and glistening. They look like amethyst gemstones. And it's just lovely, just in terms of the way it's shot and the way it's lit. It's really beautiful. It's a proper mm-hmm. set piece ending. It's really visually nice. It's not, here you go from afar, let's drop something in the middle of the Arctic, quotation marks.
Yeah.
It's an actual ending. And there's loads in terms of the different themes. You're going to talk about it anyway, but there's a third act because structurally mm-hmm. they have a proper plot.
Yeah, they do. They do. And, you know, I think you're right. Like, the visuals are stunning. And I think Chuck Russell just knows what he's doing with that. Like Dream Warriors too, it's like the visuals are in a different league to the other Nightmare sequels, right?
Oh,
and,
yeah.
And again, speaking of paying tribute to 50s and 60s, you know, Harryhausen and stuff, like the skeleton in Dream Warriors fighting, you know, at the end, and I don't know, there's that sort of stop motion stuff,
yeah.
and there's animatronics,
yeah.
and there's practical effect, you know, that there's a moment in Dream Warriors when all the feathers come down,
right,
in
yeah.
the sort of padded room. It looks a bit like the end of the Blob,
yeah,
doesn't it? And like, yeah, he's just really good at creating just beautiful visuals, and they all look like sort of fairy tales or something almost, don't they? They're very cool.
It's like a reminder of this is horror,
yeah,
but it's still in a fairy tale world. It's not, it's not naturalistic kind of, this is happening mm-hmm. right now. It's let's pretty this up for you. And it's still storytelling and the magic of storytelling.
So let me ask you about, like, let's talk about some of the key differences, because there is a reveal, right, in the third act that, shock upon shock, the blob isn't an alien. So we think it's an alien, of course, this whole time, as the 50s one was. It turns out it was created as, like, a weapon, right? And the real villains, and this is such an 80s trope, but the real villains are these kind of government sort of weapon people who sort of don't give a shit about the little people in this town who are all going to suffer and die at the hands of this weapon they're trying to wield, I suppose, right? What did you think of that sort of twist from the original?
Well, purely from a storytelling point of view, it gives it an actual third act and a surprise, which the original doesn't have any second act, really. And there is no big reveal. It's just, oh, they've worked out that, oh, it doesn't like the cold because they went into a freezer. Okay, fine, done. We're wrapped up. But it does play into that, the same kind of paranoia and anxiety. It's just the source of it is a different source. So it's that kind of post-Vietnam war. Oh, the government's lied to us. It's manipulated us. It's mm-hmm. kept, you know, it has its secrets and it's all using us. I think the reality is, I think we all kind of know that, right? I don't know.
Yeah.
I'm not being paranoid. Need to be careful what I say. But I think there's, you know, there's lots of incidents in history that can make people feel that way or buy into conspiracy theories. And I think at that particular point in America, post-Vietnam, that's kind of what it's feeding on. And, you know, post-Watergate, who's saying what, who knows what. I mean, it's the same decades later with, you know, post-Iraq and things like that, you know. So it feeds very much into that sentiment of what are they doing that they aren't telling us, and are we all lab rats, basically. But it's really interesting, that sort of flip of, oh, it's an alien. No, it's not. It's an experimental virus.
Mm-hmm.
And the original it's looking at the advancements of science, but tying back to nuclear warfare and that nuclear threat. And is someone going to drop the H-bomb on us? Mm-hmm. That kind of fear. Whereas this goes into biological warfare.
Yes,
It's still warfare. It's just that the threat has changed. And this is at the hands of the people's government. People who vote. And, you know, the government is supposed to be responsible to its people.
Yeah.
So it's just changed that sense of what the threat is and who's behind that threat, which is a really interesting... I think it's a really smart script. It's such a smart script. It really is.
Yeah, it is. And it's obviously a polar inversion of the 50s style, where it's like the American military will swoop in and save the day. And it's the polar opposite here. The American military are going to fuck us all, essentially, in this movie. This was present even 10 years earlier with Invasion of the Body Snatchers, which we talked about with Donald Sutherland. And that version is obviously so much fresh, like post-Watergate Vietnam paranoia thriller. And this movie has that too. And it also has that kind of that 80s thing of sort of... I made a Inside Cinema essay with the writer Leslie Byron Pitt, who wrote about... this thing that he called cinema jerks, I think, or cinema assholes, that are like, they're not like the villains, they're not like the main villains, but they're the sort of dickhead characters that you kind of hate more. So, for example, what's the character called in Aliens that basically, like, essentially hands her over to the alien because he works for the company? Is it Burke?
Paul Reiser's character.
Yeah, yes, exactly. Burke, like, that person.
No, hang on. Oh, here we go.
I always forget their names. But, like, those types of people, the kind of, like, money-hungry bureaucrats, and there are so many of those types of characters in 80s movies. There's one in Ghostbusters, the one that, like, makes them shut down their office and releases all the ghosts. There's RoboCop. There's, like, the company that creates RoboCop, right? There are these sort of human antagonists that are actually even more despicable than the monsters most of the time, right? And, like, we talked about Day of the Dead. It's like Romero's films are filled with those characters as well, aren't they? Like,
God. And, I'd rather be eaten by the zombie than spend loads of time with those people.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. And I think that is a real 80s trope as well. I think it's the mix of kind of, like you said, Watergate and Vietnam and all of that paranoia, but also mixed with that sort of greed of the 80s as well, and that sort of hostility towards, like, the sort of yuppie Wall Street kind of, you know, twats, basically, as well. So, yeah, there's a lot of interesting sort of stuff coming into play, I think, with these characters.
And that stuff about teenagers as well. You know, in the 50s, it was, you know, the horror comics, ooh, teenagers, this is bad for you. And then it becomes, you know, the video nasties. And then just slightly after that, it's rap music's bad for you, and Tipper Gore and all of her lot putting parental advisory and censoring music. And then the
Mary
video
Whitehouse
games.
And
yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's all still there. All of that stuff still comes up now. Oh, things that are shocking, things that shouldn't be seen. Don't release The Hunt in cinemas because this is going to be dangerous. It's like, you see that movie? Why not release that? What?
And, but it's true. And it's like, that's what's really fascinating about when you look at the original films from the 50s versus the remakes, is that so much is different, but also so much hasn't changed as well. There's certain themes that just carry over, right? 30 years later, they're exactly the same, you know, I love that.
I think what's really interesting about The Blob as well, I keep hearing about different remakes. I think Rob Zombie, God.
Yes, fucking hell. I'm so glad he hasn't made one.
Rob Zombie, I think, was tied to a remake of it, which is pretty sad to read. Sorry, Rob Zombie fans, I don't mean to be judgmental, but I am.
But yeah, it's really interesting. There's something about that story, right? The Blob. And I think it's maybe because The Blob in itself is so blank. Like, The Blob could literally be anything, and you can change what it is depending on what you make your story about. So it's not even, The Blob isn't even an alien from outer space in this film. It's a weapon, a biological weapon, like you said. So it's like, The Blob can be anything in any era, I suppose. It's quite malleable.
I really like, I hadn't really made the parallel between them, which is kind of strange, but Creepshow and the Geordie Verrill story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's another Blob style story, which I love, but I just love Creepshow.
Is that the story? Is that the one with Stephen King?
Stephen King.
Yeah, where he gets the plants.
Yeah,
I actually thought that when I watched the both versions of The Blob with the old man. It's definitely there. And of course, Creepshow is all, you know, those sort of 50s throwbacks, isn't it? Yeah, you're so right. And then you've also got the priest character in this movie, right? Who's kind of interesting, and he collects the little pink glowing crystals, and then of course he's got his own little blob at the end. What did you think of him as a character in this?
He's sort of not particularly present until the end, but then of course his function is to go, I'm a sort of religious megalomaniac who will receive a message from God, and then I will unleash this on the earth. But arguably, you could say that at that point, that's the way lots of politicians thought. They had lots of power in their hands and they would be able to release, you know, weapons of mass destruction at any point. And there was that, well, there still isn't, a mutual assured destruction from the 50s, you know, going forward. So it feels like it's a kind of metaphor for that, but in a different way.
Totally. And like church and state, right? That it's like it's like the government and the military that have hold of this weapon, and then it's the priest. You're like, oh shit, you know.
What's worse?
Exactly. So that's a really fun little ending as well, again, like kind of quite subversive, I think, in a way that it's like, oh, we had our big epic ending and now the church have got hold of this weapon, and you're like, oh my god. But yeah, I loved that about it as well. It's got some really interesting things to say, I think, this movie, you know.
It does, and also it's still a surprise because you're like, oh, I've had a really nice ending now.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
Great, the blob's dealt with, it looked pretty, oh, and there might be a sequel. And there's this other dimension to it. Mm-hmm. I think it's just a great script.
It is a great script.
It's such a great script. Do you know what? I'm gonna go through the internet and I'm gonna mine it for every piece of Frank Darabont stuff. You know that he was one of the best script doctors.
He
was one of the most widely booked and uncredited screenwriters as a script doctor on things like Saving Private Ryan and The Fan and stuff like that.
That's interesting. Yeah.
What a legend.
What a legend.
I just want to hang out and have a drink with Frank Darabont. I really do.
I know. And I kind of would like to with Chuck Russell as well, because I just feel
like... we should request them as guests at Frightfest.
I know. Like, I really would love to. I'm fascinated by Chuck Russell now, since I've seen how his filmography and how it kind of ended. And I'm like, what's he doing now? Like, what he made such classics. And yeah, I think he's... that's really interesting, isn't it, when filmmakers kind of do that and then they sort of disappear a bit. But I think what a brilliant job. I'm so glad that I finally got to see this movie.
Yeah, when you were saying, I was like, oh my god, I've seen this loads. But at the same time, I guess, yeah, there's loads of films like that where if it wasn't in your video shop or in the window at that point, kind of easy to miss. And particularly now, I know obviously there's so many streaming platforms, but unless something's sort of put in front of your eyes and it's part of your subscription package, you're kind of like, oh, what do I want to seek out and watch?
Yeah.
You know, if you've got Shudder, Mubi, BFI Player, Netflix, Amazon, you rent from Curzon, you do this and that. There's just so many different platforms. There's so much to watch all of the time. And it's not something that people will often go, you have to watch this.
Yeah.
It's not, it's kind of not one of those horror films. It's not like Dream Warriors or The Evil Dead.
Exactly.
Or Halloween or Friday the 13th. Or even things like The Burning or Body Snatchers or Dead and Buried. It's definitely...
It's slightly more niche or cult, isn't it, for some reason?
Yeah.
But it shouldn't be.
Yeah,
it's, yeah, it's such an impressive piece of work. It also reminds me a bit of like Gremlins too, like Joe Dante movies. I think there's a Joe Dante feel to this movie as well. Again, that kind of like fun sort of romp, I suppose, you know. And again, there's that feeling, obviously Joe Dante always sort of paying homage to 50s horror that he grew up with as well, right? And monsters from the 30s and that kind of thing. And it's just something that is like so present in this as well. I loved it when it's on the ceiling in the projection room of the theater as well.
But here's the thing, in the original it's only the opening song that says it's on the walls, it's here, it's there. But in this film it literally is everywhere.
Yeah, it is.
And you can see people inside the blob desperately trying to get out. It's pretty gruesome.
Yes, when they're stuck inside it as well.
Oh my God.
It's cuz actually that really took me by surprise as well. As somebody, I knew nothing about this film and I didn't know who our main characters were going to be. And when it starts off and that kind of main jock kid like goes on the date with Shawnee Smith and runs over the guy and goes to the hospital with her, and I thought, okay, he's going to be our main... And then he gets offed super quickly.
Immediately.
When he's trapped in that kind of blob, you know, it's really gruesome and...
Yeah,
and
he's really... Yeah, it's really quite something.
Yeah.
But Kevin Dillon, I mean...
Yeah, what did you think of it? Because obviously he's made quite a career. He's been in Entourage and a bunch of other stuff. But
I was going to say, but he's not Matt Dillon, is he?
No, he's not, is he? And actually, Matt Dillon has had an interesting, weird career as well. But yeah, I think he's slightly better actor than Kevin Dillon, probably, by the looks of it.
Also, Matt Dillon looks like Matt Dillon.
Yeah.
So, look. I remember Matt Dillon in those 80s movies. I was like, who is he? So I kind of feel like, bless Kevin Dillon, because he was in Platoon. He was in Platoon before
that's right.
this film.
Yeah.
What a leap. That's kind of weird.
Mm.
But I feel like Chuck Russell said to his assistant or his casting director, can you get me a Dillon, Matt Dillon? And they just
they
wrote down
Dillon.
And they rang his agent and went, okay, cool. And they came back to Chuck Russell and Chuck went, so is Dillon available? They're like, yeah, Dillon's available.
He's
talking me up for it. Loves the script. He's coming in. And they're like, great, put his name on a chair. Get his name on the chair. Get that printed on the back of that chair.
Dillon.
And then it arrives. And Chuck Russell's like looking at him going, who's this guy?
Yeah, who's this guy?
Who is who is this? And then his pure, poor little assistant is like, Kevin.
Okay. Kevin, sorry about that.
Sorry.
Did he not do it for you in this film, Kat? You know, with his mullet and his leathers and everything. Not a fan?
Look. Right. If he's trying to be a bad boy like James Dean, like 50s James Dean.
Yeah, or Steve McQueen, I suppose, but yeah.
Exactly. But at the same time, he's not even like a Kinnicky in Greece kind of bad boy. He's sort of, bless him, he's got long hair, like he's going to be dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
But he's a bad boy with a heart and he's nice with Shawnee Smith and he, you know, tries to help her. And he's not a bad kid. He's just kind of misunderstood.
I could have done with Shawnee Smith being the central character over him, actually, in a way.
Well, she's set up to be, isn't she?
Yeah,
and she's got loads of agency, but it's still, because it kind of opens on her and you're introduced to her immediately and then the jock boyfriend dies and she's, you know, there's the snow truck moment and she's fighting and she's there with a machine gun and she's really going for it. And saving her brother and stuff like that. But at some crucial moments, she is pulled away by him. And I'm like, yeah, she could eat you alive.
Yeah.
Never mind the blob killing you.
Yeah.
So it does kind of rob her of some of that glory in those moments. But she's a cut above a load of female characters in those 80s horror films.
Yeah.
She's no Ripley, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
She is no Ripley. And she's not a patch on, you know, Neve Campbell in Scream and stuff. She doesn't have quite that kind of character journey, but at the same time, she's still really good in it and it sets her up as a Scream queen with a sore career to come. But yeah, Kevin Dillon he's a bit wet for someone who's meant to be dangerous. He's a bit wet. I mean, I could probably push him over with my index finger without even trying.
He's very, very pouty as well, wasn't he? It's kind of interesting. But yeah, overall though, I loved it. If I had one criticism, it was, where was the novelty song in this one? Do you know what I would have liked? I would have liked an 80s like punk rock, like a Dokken cover of The Blob by Burt Bacharach, right? That's what they should have done. They should have done like an 80s glam rock cover of the original Blob song. That's what I'd have liked.
Completely. No, do you know what? Maybe I can live without the novelty song.
Yeah.
I can, because then it just makes the 50s Blob have something unique and super, super memorable.
I want that Blob song played at my funeral, I've decided. It's incredible.
Oh, is that what you want? I think I should have Ding Dong the Witch is Dead at mine.
That's good. So there you go. Is there anything else you want to mention on the 1988 Blob? Anything we've missed? Any other highlights or any criticisms? Go on.
Yes, and it's not necessarily about the Blob. It's more about The Stuff.
Oh, yeah, go on.
Which came out a few years before, and I saw that before I saw The Blob.
Mm-hmm.
And so when I think about The Stuff, and I'm a bit spoiled because I've got one of the stuff. The Stuff's a mid-80s Larry Cohen film, and basically the alien is a white blobby jelly thing that replicates and becomes a soft dessert that people can go and buy in shops. And it becomes a bit body snatchers, but it's a message about capitalism and greed and consumerism rather than there's a takeover from outer space and all of this. It's very different kind of themes. But that's something that I think is also one of those classic 80s alien movies. And I think because I saw that before The Blob, that I hold even more dear. And I love The Blob remake. So anyone that likes The Blob or is really curious about it needs to see the stuff. Because for some reason, I don't think it's even as well known as The Blob, the remake. It's really, really strange.
The stuff is... I think it's slightly... I don't want to be mean about The Stuff.
Don't be, because I might kill you. I might send you a part of The Stuff. I love The Stuff. I love it.
It's slightly more like... B-movie than The Blob, though, I would say.
Yeah, it is. It's definitely a bit more B-movie than the remake of The Blob, absolutely. I think that's why I think I like it more, because it feels like it has more of the roots of the original Blob.
That's true, yeah, it does.
But also a slightly stronger message in what it's trying to say. But it's also got some good effects as well, actually. It's got some great effects and some set pieces, and Michael Moriarty's always... a bit strange and interesting, and it looks visually interesting too.
I think you're right, because the Blob remake feels like it owes more of a debt to David Cronenberg and The Thing and Invasion of the Body Snatchers, the remake. And whereas you're right, The Stuff actually does feel like it owes more of a debt to like 50s monster movies, doesn't it?
It totally does, because Larry Cohen was one of those people writing. He wrote The Invaders. And Q and all of those kinds of movies. But because he was around and writing at that point, it makes sense that someone who created The Invaders would also write something like The Stuff and still carry that through. But hey, he also wrote Phone Booth, which is tremendous.
Yeah, you know, it's a great little film. Thriller. Yeah, really good.
Not remotely B-movie.
No, absolutely. So there you go. Well, it's been such a joy. And like, do you think that these two movies, do you think they still hold up? I mean, I'm guessing you think probably one holds up better than the other, but like The Blob from the 50s and The Blob from the 80s, are these two movies that you'd still recommend to horror fans, do you think?
I think you have to recommend them to horror fans, because you can't understand and appreciate modern horror without understanding its roots. And I think, particularly because good horror is always about something else. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I love a good slasher, but a lot of them, and I'm a big slasher fan, aren't really about anything. But I think horror is at its best when it's about something else, and the filmmakers and the writers are influenced by what's going on around them. And at that particular point in history, it always makes for interesting viewing, particularly when you watch it back, you know, decades later, and then draw those comparisons between 50s and 80s, you know.
Yeah.
McCarthyism right through to Reaganism. You're like, oh, actually, how much has really changed?
Totally. Yeah.
So I think it's always really interesting. And I think particularly those B movies, they're always fun at midnight showings or festivals, and they're quite culty, and you can have a good drink and a good laugh, but you can also appreciate them. And at the time, even though some of them, the effects might not hold up, or there's been advancements in filmmaking techniques and editing, and all of the craft of filmmaking has evolved so much, particularly in terms of small budget comparisons, but you can still appreciate that at the time they probably put their heart and soul into it, you know.
Yeah,
and they really tried to make something fantastic. And I think as much as the 50s Blob feels very slow at times, and you don't really see much of the Blob, and Steve McQueen is kind of phoning it in a bit, I'm sure that they still worked really hard on that, she says.
Yeah, I'm sure, definitely.
And lots of people really enjoyed it at the time. And it's been so massively influential on so many films and TV shows and filmmakers who really owe a great debt to films like that. And all of the 50s films that came just before it, actually, like Body Snatchers was before it. Mm-hmm. Everybody owes such a debt to them. So I think they should be viewed and enjoyed, and... and respected, actually, because mm-hmm. it's bloody hard to make anything, even if it's a short film, even if it's something on your phone sometimes with your mates and you're herding cats. It's bloody hard.
Yeah.
It's really bloody hard. At the same token, I still think the best thing about it is the song for that 50s one.
Let me tell everyone, you can listen to it on Spotify, because I have.
Love it.
The Blob by the Four Blobs. I love that. Written by Burt Bacharach and performed by the Four Blobs. Incredible.
I'm going to make it my ringtone on my phone. I totally
please
am.
Please do. Please do.
I just love it.
It's so good. So there you go. Kat, thank you so much for joining me. And just remind us, is there anything out there that you want to plug, or any kind of... anything you want to mention before we wrap up?
Yes. Short film that I co-wrote and produced and production designed called Bloodshed is out there. That is on Amazon Prime.
Mm-hmm.
I think Connie, which I wrote and directed, I think that's also on iTunes and on the Shorts TV subscription platform.
Awesome.
That you can see via Amazon Prime as well. I'm about to make more shorts, and I've got a feature film in development with Kato Pictures, which is a very spooky,
amazing,
very, very spooky, ghostly film. So, my first feature film.
Oh, my God. Congratulations. That's so exciting.
I know.
I can't wait.
Pandemics won't hold me down.
I know. Well, I can't wait to, at some point in the future, have you on the podcast discussing your own feature. So I can't wait.
Oh, my God. Can you imagine?
Yes. Ugh. Kat, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you very much, Mike. Pleasure as always. We need to do this more often.
And that's it for this week. Thank you so much for listening, and a huge thank you one more time to my brilliant guest, Cat Davies. So please do get in touch. What did you think of these two movies? The Blob from the 50s, which, you know, we kind of appreciated, but we weren't massive fans of, and The Blob from the 80s, which we were both massive fans of. Do you agree with us? Let me know your takes. Email me, evolutionofhorror@gmail.com. You can also find us on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Letterboxd. And if you want to discuss this week's episode with fellow listeners, then join the discussion group. That's the Evolution of Horror discussion group. You can find that on Facebook. Don't forget, we've still got a few t-shirts and hoodies left in our merch store. You can pick up yours anywhere in the world. We send internationally. You can pick it up at evolutionofhorror.com/shop. If you want to support the making of this podcast, then you can sign up to our Patreon and get loads of benefits like discounts on merch as well as regular bonus content. You can sign up at a $5, $10 or $20 level. $20 level will let you get every single bonus treat imaginable and make you an official Evolution of Horror sponsor, like this week's sponsor, Liberty. Head on over to patreon.com/evolutionofhorror. You can find this podcast on all major podcast platforms, including iTunes, Podbean, Stitcher, Acast, Libsyn, and Spotify. And don't forget, if you haven't done so already, we would be so, so grateful if you could spare a moment to drop us a little rating or review on Apple Podcasts, which really helps us get discovered by new listeners. So, we've got one more week to focus on 50s alien invasion movies before we move on. Next week is going to be an episode of two halves. In the first half of the discussion, I'm going to be joined by two brand new guests. You might know them as the co-hosts of the Strong Language and Violent Scenes podcast, Mitch and Andy. And they are going to be talking to me about a movie that is perhaps the most notorious 50s alien sci-fi movie of all, Ed Wood's Plan 9 from Outer Space. That is going to be a very entertaining deep dive discussion. We couldn't not cover that movie, right? So in the first half of that discussion, we'll be discussing Plan 9 from Outer Space. And then in the second half of the episode, Kevin Lyons is going to pop back in, and we're going to be rounding up our 50s alien movies with a little also-rans. Kev is going to be recommending a handful of other alien invasion sci-fi horror movies to recommend to you guys, spoiler-free. So next week should be an incredibly fun episode. Join us then for all of this and more on the Evolution of Horror.